The psalmist put it this way in Psalms 103. Bless thee the Lord all with all my soul, with all within me. Bless thee the Lord. Bless the Lord with all my soul, with all within me. Bless him for his benefits.
Amen.
If God has benefited you this morning, if he's been better to you than you've been to yourself, can't you say amen,
amen.
And thank you, Jesus. He has been better to us than we've been to ourselves. I am so thankful to know that God is alive. That he sits high and look low.
Amen.
I'm so glad with all the stuff that you can go through in a week that you know Christ has confirmed himself in your life. Because if it had not been for Jesus, you wouldn't be here this morning.
Amen.
The fact that you're here is a confirmation that God is alive and well. And that's enough to give God glory this morning, because if it had not been for God, who was on our side, what in the world would I do?
Amen.
Oh, I remember amen. Peter declared in John 6, around the 66th verse or so, when Jesus looked at him and said, Peter, will you leave me also? Mm-hmm. Peter looked back at him and said, Master, where would I go?
Uh-huh.
To whom would I go to? Mm-hmm. To whom would you go to? When you need a friend in the midnight hour, who are you going to call?
Amen.
When you need a bridge over troubled waters, who would you go to? When all your friends forsake you, who will you go to? When your loved ones have let you down, who will you go to?
Amen.
Oh, I believe that Amen. He has the words of life, and we ought to be thankful for the Son of God.
Amen.
All that God has done, that we may have a right to the tree of life. Now, if I can get you just to turn this for a minute over to Matthew chapter 13, 18 through 23, and just shout amen when you have it.
Amen.
There's few people have it. Y'all should give me a shout amen when you have it.
Amen.
Amen. And now listen, the Spirit of God
yes, sir.
Wants to connect with the people of God this morning. And one of the things that the Bible emphatically shows us is that whenever the word goes out, there's a confirmation of the word from the people of God by the affirmation of amen.
Man.
And so when you hear the word of God, if you so happen to hear the word of God this morning, because you confirm that you heard the word of God,
man.
By acknowledging not to me, but saying, yeah, Lord, to the God of heaven,
yes,
the
Lord.
Most High God.
Man.
Don't let the devil take your joy this morning.
Mm-hmm.
When you hear the preached word of God, something in your spirit ought to come alive and begin to testify that you heard a word from the Lord.
Man.
Are y'all all right this morning?
Yeah.
All right now. And so now, if you sit beside somebody, just warn your neighbor.
Mm-hmm.
Just say, neighbor,
yeah.
This morning,
morning,
I just might shout.
Yeah.
All right. If you didn't say you waste, I just might shout.
Yeah.
I say amen. Now, if you know you're not going to shout, then don't say it. But if you just might shout this morning, look at your neighbors, and I'm warning you in a shout. I was at SeaWorld, and they had that big Shamu was swimming around.
Mm-hmm.
And as he swam around, it was some years ago before they got so technical with Shamu. I like the aggressive Shamu. But they had an area where you sit down there. And when you sit down, you look on the back of the seat and said, you're in a splash zone. And if you sit there, you have no right to get upset if you get your hair too wet. Because you sat in a
splash
zone. All right, now listen, bring into the church.
Mm-hmm.
If you're sitting beside a sanctified, full of the Holy Ghost, mm-hmm. thankful, grateful child of God,
uh-huh.
if you're sitting beside them, you need to give them a warning and tell them you're sitting in a shout zone.
Amen.
And I just might shout.
Amen.
I don't see anybody warning nobody. I just might shout this morning because I'm in love with the Word of God. How many love the Word of God?
Amen.
Amen. We're glad to have our guests this morning from the Missouri area, from St. Louis, Illinois. Have good friends out there. That's also an area that Brother Carter is from, and so we're glad to have you here. We welcome you in all of us. Sir, welcome you to the wonderful state of California, in particular the finest city, San Diego. Where we are still thriving to get a team like the Dallas Cowboys, but God is good. Amen. All right, amen. We welcome you here. And other guests, you're welcome here, not to just this, but any services. And here's the most important thing. If I preach anything to our guests, you don't quite understand. You stop me in the middle of my sermon if need be.
Amen.
And say, because you explain that. Amen. And I promise you, I'll give you a Bible answer for your Bible question.
Amen.
Because we are dealing with the souls of men.
Uh-huh.
That we must be clear that there is a heaven to gain and a hell to share.
Man.
That God has something special for every one of you that's here this morning.
Uh-huh.
If you receive it, were you receiving this morning?
Yeah.
Were you receiving this morning?
Yeah.
Let's look carefully. This is for those who love the Word of God. I want to talk to you about nothing but the Word of God. Nothing but the Word of God. Here we have a parable in Matthew chapter 13. And the parable is teaching the when and the how and the what that transpires when the Word of God goes forth. As it relates to the kingdom of God. And what's interesting about Ben Levi, whose name is now Matthew. You remember that initially it was Levi who was a tax accountant. Came into contact with Christ. Changed his name to Matthew. He left a crooked business and got in the business of the cross.
Amen.
And what's interesting is that my focus hermeneutically is not teaching you whom Levi is or Matthew is. But it is teaching you who Jesus is through the text. Because Matthew, the tax collector, he quantifies some hundredfold, some 50, some hundredfold, because he's a tax accountant. But most of his writing in this text are the direct words from Christ. And so when we exegete the text, it's a helpful understand not only from a psychological, not psychological, from a theological standpoint or a philosophical standpoint, we must exegete the text not from Matthew's perspective, but from Jesus Christ's perspective himself.
Amen.
According to the Word of God. Now, when you look in your Bibles, you'll find that Matthew chapter 13, verse 19 is mostly written in what color?
Red.
Which means that this is Matthew taking account of not what Matthew said, but what
Jesus
says. Therefore, it is incumbent of every listener to especially tune in, because this is not just anybody talking, but this is the King of Kings, Lord of Lords, Host of Hosts. This is Jesus Christ, Emmanuel, God with us, who is teaching concerning the kingdom of God. Are y'all with me this morning? And so he says, hear ye not, listen to me, therefore. I want to talk to you about the kingdom of God. And I want to talk to you about when the word is sown. I want you to know that when the word is sown, the devil is busier than he ever has been. Whenever the preached word goes forth, something takes place. Even while you're sitting here right now, you're having trouble trying to listen, trying to take in, because Satan is busy. He don't want you to hear this word the way God wants you to receive it. But you got to learn that when this word is sown, something's happening. What does the Bible say? He says, when anyone heareth the word of who? The kingdom of God. And understandeth it not. Now, understandeth it not in the Greek Bible is not there. It was placed there because when you hear God's word and there is no response to God's word, then we must conclude that there is a lack of understanding to God's word. It's placed there and it can fit there and it doesn't change the context, the structure of the text. But it's placed there because that something happened, that Jesus has been preaching and teaching and folks still don't see him as the Son of God. I tell preachers all the time, sometimes you're preaching and they just sit back and look at you like you a space alien or something. You know why they're looking at you funny? Because why are you preaching? Somebody, there's another force that's busy, there's another spirit that's busy that don't want you to receive God's word. And then when you do hear God's word, y'all know I'm telling the truth, when you do hear God's word, sometimes Satan and have them bills messing with you, you can't even enjoy God's word. Sometimes while you're preaching, he'll have you so busy looking at everybody else, thinking about everybody else, you won't receive or understand God's word, not because something wrong. want you to receive God's word. Why? Because the word of God can save your soul. Am I right about it? The word of God can lift you up during some bad times. The word of God can inform you. It can edify you. The word of God can give you peace at night. The word of God can strengthen you during weak moments. The word of God can make you wise for young years. And the devil wants you to hear God's word. So without my preaching, and that's the time somebody come over and start talking, tell them, honey, I'm trying to get the word.
Man.
And then some of the best gossip is doing preaching. Amen. Now this one's saying, get busy. I'm up here preaching and sweating, tired of my suit shirt coming out of my pants. And I'm preaching, I'm just having a good time. And here comes the devil talking, look at his shirt. Don't look at my shirt. Listen to the word. Don't worry about my shirt. You ain't out of my shirt. You didn't clean my shirt. You need to listen to God's
word.
Amen. Now listen, if you don't love God's word, then you're going to be in trouble. Because I've been giving you a good hefty dose of God's word. What does the text say? The text says that this enemy comes along while you're sitting in the pew this morning. And what does he do to the word? He catches away that which was sown in the heart. The Bible says in Romans chapter 6:17 that you once were the servants of sin, having obeyed that form of doctrine from the heart. There's something that's preached that then distinguishes itself from anything else that's preached. If you go to a church and they preach something that you always heard, that everything about you agree to, you have had much preaching. But when you sit in the house of God and the seed of God is planted, and it makes you stop and scratch your head for a moment, and make you look around and say, whoa, wait a minute. If it convicts you in your seat, if it moves you in your spirit, if it edifies you in your mind, it's because the word of God is truly being sown. But the devil will come and try to take the word of God.
Amen.
All right, this is who's talking here?
Jesus.
It's Jesus. All right, now back to the text we go. Now the text says that he catches the word of God. And then it gives a condition. I want to go through here. He gives a condition. Some stoning, some choked out the word of God. How did he take away the word? Well, it choked out the word of God. It snatched out the word of God. It didn't allow room to grow from the word of God. Have you ever seen a seed germinate before? Have you ever seen? See, some of us have been in the church all our life, and we've never had anything done with the seed of God in our life. Let me say it again. Do you just have the seed? Or do you have the germination of the seed? Because without the germination of the seed, it's just a seed sitting on the soil. Whenever a seed is planted, the seed has to come in contact with the germ.
Right. Come on.
So Jesus is teaching. Verse number 20. And some fell by the wayside. The seed is taught. The word is proclaimed. But it's sitting on the hearts of men on the surface. When a seed begins to germinate, a little fork comes out of the seed. It has to come in contact with the germ. And when it sticks into the germ, which is down in the soil, it begins to take root if the soil is conditioned right. And when it takes root, it transforms itself from a seed to a plant. It turns from just a seed to a pea, from a pea. If it's a sunflower, it becomes from a green piece of leafy material and turns into a beautiful yellow fluorescent sunflower. But the only way that the seed can grow is the seed got to come in contact with the germ.
Man.
What y'all talking about? What you talking about, preacher? Okay. All right. The word of God won't mean anything to you until you have the word of God do something with you in front of the germ of trouble.
Amen.
The word of God will never magnify itself in your life until the word of God brings you through the germs of trials in your life.
Right.
And until you learn to count on the word of God. That's why James said in James 1 and verse number 3, count it all joy when you enter into these divers temptations. Why? Because, but let this trials and tribulation have this perfect work, its patience, because the trials that you're going through, the journeys of trial, I don't know what your trial is, but if it wasn't for the trial, you'd never turn into what God would have you, because the seed has to He said, Matthew 13, he said, listen, heaven and earth shall pass away, but my word shall live forever. There are stuff that you're going through that you've learned to depend on everything else. Now listen, while I'm preaching right now, some of this stuff is falling on stony ground. You can tell stony ground because it's looking crazy. You're looking down at your feet right now. You rolling your eyes, looking up and down, because I'm talking to some hard-headed folk. This message is not for you. I'm talking to folk who have been through something, who trusted on the word of God, counted on the word of God, faced your trial, lift your hand up when you wanted to drop your head, been through the storm, been through the fire, and God produced something out of the madness in your life. The problem you got this morning, that all your life you just heard the word of God, but you never trust the word of God in your life. And the seed has been sitting on your hard head all the days of your life. That's why you don't have no joy. Look at you. Look at you. Look at you, frowned up. Look beat, wore out, tired. Why? Because you never learned to trust and count on the word of God. I'm not talking to nobody else but you. I want you to concentrate on you. Tell the devil to leave you alone. Tell the devil, I'm trying to receive the word of God. If you hear this voice, say, devil, leave me alone. I want to receive it. Where do you want to receive it? He said, well, if the seed is planted in the home. You remember David declared as he's preaching, he's writing, thy word have I hid where?
In my heart.
In my heart. That I might not what?
Sin.
That I might not sin. Psalm 119 and verse number 11. See, for a long time in my life, I would come to the house of God and I would be so busy trying to figure out what the church is going to do. For a long time in my life, I would come to the house of God. And the only time I picked up my Bible was when I was at the house of God. For a long time in your life, you've been coming to the house of God, and you've been trying. You've heard all this preaching. Different preachers have preached, but Satan got you caught up. Sometimes he snatched the seed away because he had you mad about something. Other times he snatched the seed away because he had you worried about something. Sometimes he snatched the seed away because you wasn't interested in the word of God. Sometimes life just choked seed right out of you. Sometimes we as men of God find ourselves meeting folk who just have the seed but have not had the germination. How do you know? You can't build a church on the seed of nepotism. You can't build a church on the seed of traditionalism. You can't build a church on the seeds of economism. You can't build a church on the seeds of idealism. The church is built on the word of God. Because the text says that whenever the seed is planted, when bad day come, when trials and tribulation come, that which is not rooted will get up and walk right out the church house. See, you want to know why folk leave churches? They leave churches because they were not rooted in the word. And so I told my sister, I said, let me tell you something. I made a travesty. I made a mistake. I tried to build this church with nepotism. How many of you know what nepotism means? I tried to let families. I told, oh, that's a big family. And that's okay. But guess what? Whenever the family get mad, look at the text. Look back to Matthew chapter 13 right quick. And let me show you what God says in his word. God says, Matthew 13, but he that received the word in some places, the same as he was hearing the word, and anon with joy receiveth it. But listen to this. Yet he has no what? Root in himself. But endureth what? For a while. For when what? Tribulation and persecution arising because of what? The word of God. What happens? By and by he's offended. He's angry. And when folk get mad, they won't say amen. They're not saying amen because they're mad at God. They're mad because they don't have the word of God deep inside of them. When folk walk out of church houses, and not because the word of God failed them, it's because they have not received God's word as the foundation and pillar of truth in their life. How do you know you worship the folk who won't receive the word of God? Because they won't give God glory in the midst of trials. They won't praise God like God's been true to his word. If God's done something to you, can't you give him glory in the midst of your trials and tribulation? If God helped you by the funeral home where you were buried, your loved one, can't you raise your hand this morning and say, thank you, Jesus? If God had to do financial crisis, and the financial crisis came to sit in the house of God and rebel against God. Yeah. Have you ever seen a devil sit in the house of God, their arms folded up, looking up at the ceiling, rolling their eyes, breathing heavy, because that word slapping across the head? Devil, I'm going to keep preaching till you get up and say, I can't take it no more, and break out running. Oh, y'all ought to say amen. Amen. Have you ever seen the devil busy? The devil will not praise God.
Amen.
He will not praise God. He wants to be God. Right. He determines what he'll do, when he'll do it, and how he'll do it. Amen. When a child of God receives and his relationship with God is based on the word of God, nothing can move him from giving God glory.
Amen.
I don't care what you're going through. God's been good to you. You know God's been good to you. God's been better to you than you've been to yourself.
Man.
And don't you let nobody or nothing stop you from praising God. The Bible says that when the word of God is preached, it's going to offend some folk. And by and by, they're offended. And when folk get offended and they came to church because their daddy came here, when their daddy leave, they're going to leave right along with you. You don't want to build a church on the what?
Word of God.
The word of God. Your Christianity can only be built on what?
Word of
the
God.
The word of God. Anything else is on a shaky ground.
Man.
And I encourage each and every one of you to ask yourself, what about the seed? What about the word of God? What ground did it fall on? What have you done with the word of God? Is it stony ground? Is it ground that had no root, can take no soil? What about the word of God? And then secondly, has the word of God germinated in your life? What's been your response in trials and tribulation? If you came to church because of friendships, as soon as you're not friends with somebody, what you gonna do? You gonna leave. What's the real problem? Ain't got no word. If you had some word of God in you, there ain't a friend you got that can stop you. Somebody ought to say amen. There ain't a man in the house of God. You devil, if you had some word of God in you, it would be a man in the house of God to stop us from giving God glory in the
Amen.
House of God.
Amen.
Yeah, it's not their fault. It's not his fault. The problem is, what are you doing with the word? If you had any kind, you devil, if you had any kind of word in you, you would sit in the house of God and roll your eyes looking at the people of God. I'm trying to get all the word I can get because God has been good to me. Amen. Anyhow. Amen, church house. Rats, bats, roaches, mice, crickets, snakes, and bumblebees. God is still right anyway. Amen, anyhow. Amen. Let's look. We come to a landing spot in this lesson. Remember that the word of God is identified in the text almost 10 times. In the word of God, several things happen. First of all, the curse of this world and the deceitfulness of riches will choke out the word of God. The thorns of life and the storms of life will capsulize or incarcerate your spirit and stop you from growing as a child of God. Somebody said, leaning on the everlasting arms.
Man.
What a fellowship.
Yes, sir.
What a joy divine. I'm leaning on the everlasting arms. In times of trials and troubles and tests, I'm leaning on the everlasting arms of my Savior. When folk don't act good to me, I'm still leaning on the everlasting word of God. For heaven and earth shall pass away, but the word of God shall live forever. James says, count it all joy when you fall into diverse temptation, knowing this, that the trial of your faith worketh patience. James 1 and 3. In times of trouble, I'm still, because I'm germinating the word of God, I'm not going nowhere. I'm going to stand on God's word. When things don't go like it need to be, I'm standing on God's word. God said, I believe all of it. There ain't nothing the devil can do to move me. Not because I'm better than you, because I allow myself to come into the germ contact. And when the germs of troubles hit me, I've learned that when I get in trouble, that God can help us over troubled waters. I learned when the germs of trouble strike me and things don't go the way they need to be because of the germination. I remember the old days we used to do. If you watch the video, when a seed germinates, the little fork comes out of the seed and begins to move, and it's looking for a digging place. The word is looking for a place to dig in your heart. And once it makes connection to the heart and to the soul of man, it hooks itself. It begins to sprout its roots inside and connect the heart of man to the word of God. And when the strong winds come and when the bad days come, I'm not offended because of God's word. I'm like that island over there that when the storms came and the winds blew, the palm trees would lean, but they wouldn't fall over. Sometimes we lean, but we don't have to fall over. Am I right about it? They looked a little closer, found the germination that took place, looked down and found that each root had connected to another root and had tied themselves together. So when the storms came, they just kept standing there. Other stuff they blew around, but because they were rooted in God's word, when folk counted them out, they could count on those trees standing there like a tree that's planted by the rivers of water. Am I right about it? I'm glad this morning that I'm troubled on every side, but I'm not distressed. I'm perplexed, but I'm not in despair. I'm persecuted, but I'm not forsaken. Cast down, but I'm not destroyed. Lied on, but I keep on hoping. Talked about, but I smile anyway. Use and abuse, but I hold on to God's unchanging hand. Tried, but I come through the fire. I've come through the fire.